It's an inspiring story, inspires you to, you know, eat well. And one of the ways you can eat well, it's with a slow cooker. It's a great way to make a very elegant meal pretty easily, actually.
And healthy, too. Mm-hmm. So Chef Bill Collins is a personal chef. He joins us for another easy recipe in our kitchen. So nice to have you here, Chef Bill.
So good to be here. Thank you.
Now, this is a very unique way to cook a chicken. I would never think to put a whole chicken in my slow cooker.
I gotta tell you, either would I.
Okay.
Because, actually, until recently, I was not doing much slow cooking because most people use the slow cooker, put it on, and then go off to the office. Well, my office is a kitchen, so I don't really have the full need of it. So then I thought, well, you know, let me see what other folks are doing. And by doing something like this, it's very similar to a roast chicken. The only difference is you're not gonna have that crispy skin, but we can take care of that. But you're right, just put the whole thing in, walk away, and go off about your day.
Because what you gain in a slow cooker is the moisture factor.
It's gonna be hugely moist. I mean, it's unavoidably moist because while technically it's roasting, it's just like putting it in the oven, it's a smaller area so the steam doesn't have the big oven to dissipate in. So it just wraps around the steam, and no matter what, it's gonna be such a moist chicken. You cannot do a dry whole chicken in a slow cooker.
So it's you can't overcook it?
Well, you can overcook it so it'll be falling off the bone, but it'll still be moist and very flavorful. So you don't have to worry about a dried out chicken.
It's like roasting a chicken in a rainforest.
That's exactly.
You know, it's really moist, and you've got some foliage too, so it more or less.
You've got everything you need there, yeah.
Right, it makes it pretty. Now, the one thing you have to make sure you don't do is get a chicken that's too big for your slow cooker.
You know, that's so true, because a lot of times you see, oh boy, they've got the big roasters on sale and put a 7-pound roaster in it. It's just not going to fit. Yeah. So now, since slow cookers come in different sizes, two things to be careful of, or to be aware of, is one, make sure the chicken that you do buy will fit in. It can touch the sides a bit, and you know, that's not optimum, but that's fine. But also, the second thing to understand about your slow cooker is some go a little faster, some go a little slower. And so with something like this, we say about a 4-pound chicken will be about 6 hours, but it might be a little more, a little less. You don't want to go, say, in your mind exactly 6 hours and then be disappointed.
When you get to that point with chicken, it always gets me, because you never know when you want to pull it off, because you don't know if it's undercooked or not, and then you would hate to put it back on. Do you measure it? Is there a certain temperature you're going for, or are you guesstimating?
It's just like any other time you roast a whole chicken. You want to take its temperature and stick an instrument thermometer right inside, and I'll show you after, because my instrument thermometer is not right here.
Okay.
And you put it right between the leg and the thigh, and that should read about 165, 170 degrees. And what's going to happen is once you take it out and it sits for a bit, it'll continue to stay a little bit warmer. Mm-hmm. So you're right exactly where you want it to be. One other thing about a slow cooker, say you figure 6 hours, and you're delayed getting home, picking up the kids or whatever, and you set it for 6 or even 7 hours, what's going to happen is it'll turn itself off but has a warm setting. Most of them do. And that way you don't have to worry about, oh, all this bacteria is going to set in. So you can do it very safely and still be delayed and have a good chicken.
Oh, I love hearing that. Makes life easy, you know?
That's exactly what it's for.
Now, what size is this chicken?
That's about 4¼ pounds.
Okay. Now, what did you put on top of there?
I just put a little smear of olive oil, a little salt and pepper, and a little paprika, and an onion inside, in the cavity, as we call it, to give it some flavor.
Okay.
And so then what I also have here is I cut up some carrots and celery and some lemon. And so I've already squeezed some lemon juice on top of there. So I'm just gonna put that in, and now just kind of spread it out there, because that's gonna form a nice base for the chicken.
And all of those vegetables, and the chicken for that matter, is going to put off a lot of moisture, which will fill up the pan a little bit.
Exactly. And all you do is put that on top. And what I like to do, a little addition, is just squeeze a little bit of lemon on top.
All right.
And then drop the half lemon in there, because that's going to give you some flavor as well.
I like how it doesn't have, the carrots are just raw, the celery is just, the stalks on there too. So
exactly, just throw everything,
because
it's all edible. And you know, I don't even peel the carrots. I scrub them off to get the dirt off, because the skin is, you know, very healthy and nutritious, and it's going to give you a nice flavor.
Sounds good to me.
So then all you do, put the lid on.
Set it, forget it, come home. 6 hours. Don't go on a vacation.
No, you don't want to do that. That might be a little dried out.
A little bit dry.
But that's the great thing about the slow cooker, is that you can go about your day, and it just makes it easy.
An 8-hour workday, it's still okay, because it'll go to the warming setting, so it's fine.
Exactly.
And now, you said it won't necessarily make it crispy. When it is ready, it's nice and moist. How do you get it to be crispy if you want it to?
Well, there are two things you can do. One big thing you can do is take it out and put it in the broiler, in the oven, and or even just a high setting oven, but not in your highest setting. You don't want touching the coils.
Okay.
So you put it about halfway, into the oven, and give it about 10 minutes or so, and that will dry out the skin a little bit, and make it a little bit crispy. And because crispy I can't even say it.
Crispy skin.
Thank you.
It's a tongue twister, but it's also tasty on the tongue. So.
And a lot of people like that. But it's also really good if you don't do it. You just come home, everybody's running around, you want to get dinner on the table. It's just very tasty anyway.
The way it is.
Yep.
So going forward, this is done. It's set.
It's set, and just leave the house.
Well, then we're going to set it, we're going to forget it, but we're going to remember you. We're going to come back to you a little later in the show. Okay?
We are back with Chef Bill Collins, and he's a personal chef. We're in the Masterkill Kitchen, and we're going to learn about the four knives that you need to have in your kitchen.
Because a lot of times, Bill, by the way, thanks for sticking around.
Thank you.
A lot of times you can go to the big box stores and you can buy a big block of knives, or 12 of them there.
Yep.
That seems superfluous now because you're telling me there's only four we need.
Well, yes, but oftentimes with the big box ones, they'll have like a number of steak knives. So, you know, that those are good to have too. But these are the basic ones you want to have in your kitchen. Now, a lot of folks say you need three knives. I disagree. I think you need four. And so...
So let's take it down the line from big to small. What's this first knife we have right
here? That one's called the chef's knife. And these usually come in either a 10 inch or 8 inches long. A lot of people get the shorter one. And I say, even if you're not very comfortable in the kitchen just yet, get the bigger one. Because it's actually counterintuitive. It's easier to use a longer chef's knife than a short one. Now, there are two key things to remember. One of them is the knife holding the hand is important. The hand not holding the knife, is just as important. Because, and also the way you hold the knife. A lot of people hold them like this, but your knuckles hit, or they'll hold the finger out like that. You don't have enough control. I say take your thumb and forefinger and pinch it just like that. You know, not to hold it tight, pinch it, but just hold it like that, and you can have control left and right.
Oh, okay. Huh.
Now, the other thing with this hand, a lot of times people cut and they hold the food like that because that's comfortable. Mm-hmm. However, that's how you lose your fingertips or you
right.
cut them.
That's dangerous.
And what they teach in cooking school, and it takes a while to get used to this, you want to hold your fingers up like this because this way...
So worst case scenario.
It works as a guard.
And your knuckle and the space between your knuckle and the tip of your finger, that'll get the brunt of it.
Exactly, but there is no brunt. It's just going to slide up and down. Now, this is also why the longer knife is important, because with a shorter knife, you have to lift it up higher. And you do increase the chance of cutting, but also you don't have to lift it as high with the longer knife.
I see you're doing circular strokes, so you're not just going up and down.
No, there are two basic cuts, and 95% of the time, you never have to even lift your knife off the cutting board. So you're either going to cut like this. See, it's not leaving the end there.
Yeah.
Or as I'll demonstrate actually with some cilantro, the other one is you just take it and actually I'm going to cut a bit off right here. And then with your hand on the edge, you just cut it up until it's all cut down.
Mm-hmm. Just maybe if you're cutting garlic or something like that.
Exactly, because you want to slice the garlic first and then start cutting it up around like that. And the vast majority of what you're doing will be those two cuts. And so when you see like some TV commercials where you see the knife flying, that's not good for a couple of reasons, especially if you're not good with knives, is you're definitely going to take up something from the wrist down.
Okay, so we don't want that.
Because you don't have control. I guarantee. I'll put that in writing. But the other thing is here, when you've got the knife down like that, the knife's doing the work. Otherwise, if you're lifting it up like that, your shoulder's doing the work.
Mm-hmm.
And this way, it's just more efficient. It's not as cool as a not flying knife.
True, but it's a lot safer.
Who cares about being cool when you want your fingers?
So. Yeah, exactly.
10 fingers are more important than being cool.
Exactly.
Okay, so that's a chef's knife. That's one that you definitely want.
Yes.
What's the next knife?
The next one, this is called either an offset handled serrated knife or a deli knife. And often you see just a straight blade across.
Right.
And the reason this is a really good one to have, most people don't mention this one, is because this picks up the slack of the others. If you're cutting fruit, if you're cutting tomatoes, if you're cutting bread, the serrated there just goes right through it. For instance, let me demonstrate, first of all, let me just take these things off the board here.
Okay, that's a nice handy thing you've got there.
This is called a bench scraper, $9. It's the best thing in the world just to pick up things, put them in a bowl, put them in your soup pot, and instead of trying to balance things on the knife.
That's smart.
So this is...
And this is kind of like you're wielding a saw, like you're cutting a tree down. It's a lot of back and forth cuts.
Exactly. And the thing is, will the chef's knife do this? Absolutely. But the advantage of this is it's a lot easier, smoother, and it's actually safer because you're not trying to hack down through something the chef's knife isn't, I mean, it's made for it, but this
makes
is easier.
Life easier.
And it's less sharp, but it's sharp in a different way so that you probably have less chance of cutting your finger off.
Exactly, because even with a sharp or sometimes a less than sharp knife, try cutting through a tomato during tomato season when you've got a nice fleshy skin and you end up with a mushy red thing.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
But with this, this cuts right through tomato skin at the height of tomato season.
And I think it's fair to say, too, if you have all the right tools, you might actually eat healthier, because I would cut a pineapple much more often if I had a knife like that.
Exactly. Oh, exactly. And so now, that's exactly the way it works. You're going to eat healthier because, you know, you're going to be, it's not going to be
you're
frustrating.
You're not frustrated, right.
Yeah, it's exactly. All about being prepared. Now, yep. This next knife we have here, it's a little smaller, and it looks like a chef's knife.
It does, and that's called a utility knife. Mm-hmm. And the thing about a utility knife is it's kind of in between. So, for instance, if you are, coring cauliflower, and you kind of go around to get the top out, the chef's knife is kind of a little bit long,
yeah.
And you can't control it. But this way, you can kind of go down through the core and control a little bit easier. Or sometimes if you're slicing a block of cheese, it's sometimes easier to use that, although I often like to use this knife as well.
So you should have used a plastic knife to slice your cheese.
No,
which is what I was using
which
yesterday.
Which is what Ashley did for lunch.
That's right. And so it's just easier to do some of the smaller tasks.
So could you maybe it's call that one. More of like a details knife? It's not for the big things, it's for the littler,
it's an in-betweener. And so you might use this in the course of a meal, are preparing a big dinner, maybe once or maybe not at all.
Now let's show people this knife too. It's our last one, it's the paring knife. And just in comparison, this is how it looks.
And this is for more of the little close-up things. Say you just want to take a little something, off or maybe one or two and not doing a full slicing of this. Mm-hmm. And, it just is a little bit easier. Now notice I've got my thumb over the blade. That doesn't seem all that smart.
No, it doesn't.
But I'm not pushing up and just putting in carefully. Another way to do it is just a small little thing like that if you just need a little bit. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it really is for the much smaller jobs, not the high volume things. I wouldn't, carve a small chicken with this because you use a bigger knife, but it's when you're doing something small and close up. But really the go-to, the biggest knife, the main one you will use is the chef's knife the vast majority of the time. And then followed, in that order, actually, mm-hmm. of how you use them.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. So that's it. Those are the four knives right there. By the way, how's the chicken coming?
The chicken is coming fine. It's come out of the crock pot. We've speeded up time because it's live TV.
Yes.
And I've got it in the oven where it's the skin is getting nice and crispy now.
Oh, I can't wait. Thank you so much, Chef
Thank
Bill.
You. Thanks.
Learned so much
Thanks.
Just now. Don't go anywhere because when we come back, we're going to finish up our crock pot.
Welcome back to Mass Appeal, and once again, we are back in Studio 1A in the kitchen with Chef Bill Collins, and we have a finished chicken that looks good.
Smells good.
Yeah, it does.
They just came out of the oven.
It just came out, yep, because I warmed it up a little bit, and or I should say crisped up the skin. You can hear that's a little bit crispy there, and now you're all set to carve away and have dinner. See how moist it is, how easy that came off off the bone.
Now, this is about a 4-pound chicken. You put it in the slow cooker for about 6 hours?
For about 6 hours, yep.
And then you just threw it in the oven just under the broiler to just give it a crispy
That's exactly
finish.
It. Yep, because it's also going to come out very moist, but because it's so moist in there, you're not going to get a crispy skin.
And I think half the reason it's moist, too, aside from the fact that we put it in the slow cooker, is inside that, is that an onion, a full onion?
I put a full onion. I just quartered it, and again, that gives it flavor, so you can have some of that, plus the lime or lemon flavor that I squeezed over, so it's going to give you really nice flavor throughout. And
easy to do.
It's so easy. And then meanwhile, when you walk in the door and you're seeing what the chicken's up to, you can also, with a rice cooker, put on a cup of rice or so. It's going to give you almost 3 cups of volume of rice. And then walk away from that because you don't have to watch it on the stove. 20 minutes later, if it's white rice, or maybe 40 minutes if it's brown rice, you've got your dinner. So you've got your chicken right here. You've got your drumstick here. And if you want some of the vegetables from the pan.
Ooh, that have been soaking in those good fats and those and all that moisture.
Oh, exactly, yep.
So easy.
It is.
It's a set it and forget it day.
It's a set it and forget it day.
So now the rice cooker, is that something that, if people are out there and they're shopping, you'd recommend them getting it in their homes?
Yes, I got one as a gift and I thought, geez, a rice cooker, I'm a chef, I can put it on the stove. It's perfect. You walk away, you get distracted, especially you walk in the door. Kids, dogs, just getting in. You put it on, you walk away, you don't have to worry about boilovers as often happens on the stove.
It always happens to me.
How do you avoid a boilover?
Get a rice cooker.
But if I don't have a rice cooker.
Actually, there are two ways. size one, turn it down just as it's coming to a boil, or if you have an electric stove, set another burner on low. And so once it comes to a boil, just shift it over, and you don't have to worry about it boiling over.
10 times out of 10, mine boils over.
Oh, absolutely.
You hear that sizzle, and darn it, I didn't get it.
Exactly. And the great thing about a rice cooker is it's smarter than we can all be, because it knows if it's brown rice for 40 minutes or white rice for 20 minutes. It takes care of it every time. You don't have to do a special setting. Put it in, walk away, just like you did the morning with the rice cooker.
Come home, and dinner's ready.
Perfect.
Chef Bill, thank you so much. I never would have thought to put a chicken in my slow cooker. Now I will.
Perfect.
Thank you for being here. Thank